Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Camera Tuesday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at digital movie cameras, basically the cameras that are used to make blockbusters. So what it is? It's a very simple thing. It's a purpose-built device. What does that mean? It's basically it's built to do one thing and one thing only. It's a professional tool. It's a very specific tool. It's not a multi-tool. It's meant to do one thing. Now, if you are familiar with the video that I made last time about professional camcorders or basically professional handycams, they are meant to tackle a large scenario situation. Basically, they should be able to use in a sports system. They should be able to use in a scenario where you are, let's say, doing something close up like an interview. Now, this on the other hand goes around it by using interchangeable lens system. The idea is very simple. You use the camera and pick the lens which is suited for your need. Basically, it's like a DSLR, interchangeable lens camera. Now, so this gives them ability to actually match the quality of a proper highest end possible camera. Now, if you ever look basically a cameras of this nature, you will find they are not compact nor they are comfortable, because the principle behind building these things is very simple. It's supposed to allow you to do what you need to do, basically functionality over form. So it's not comfortable. It's not something that you can carry in in a backpack. It needs its own briefcase and supporting briefcase to just go with it. So that's why you see so many buttons, dials, antennas, things of that nature. In these antennas you see here, it's not for broadcasting purposes. They are there just so you can control the camera settings wirelessly. So, and it's a very, very alien hardware to us. Basically, if you are using a DSLR and you think you can handle this, you can, you can press record, it will record, but it's a completely different beast. So how does it actually work? Now, be mindful, when I say it's a professional tool, it actually costs more than a basically high-end car. It's a very expensive tool. That's how they can afford some of the experimental technology or highest end technology. Be mindful, also, there is no such thing as ISO or gain. It's basically a soft control. That's why you can change it in your Lightroom. However, what thing you cannot change is what we call signal to noise ratio. Basically, you have a sensor and how much noise is coming from the sensor itself, not from the environment, but the sensor itself. So to have it a very high quality circuit board that can read the sensor without introducing a lot of noise, it's very expensive. They can afford to do that because it's a very, very expensive camera, as in $10,000, $80,000, $1 million camera. That is just easy for them. So, and whenever they are building this sort of devices, there is no such thing as power limitation. Think of it this way: a DSLR has a constraint limit. It cannot consume 50 watts of power. Even a professional handycam, even though it has bigger battery, it still has a limited constraint. It should not consume more than, let's say, 5 watts per hour. These puppies, on the other hand, can consume upwards of 50, 60 watts per hour to kilowatts per hour. And the lenses that are used for these, it's what we classify as cine lenses. Now, difference between cine lenses and photography lenses is that photography lenses is designed for quick movements. Basically, you rotate your focus, you go from infinity to close up very quickly, because it's meant for point and shoot. Now, cine cams, they give you a lot of time. So if you see the rings for focusing, it's very long. The throw on them, basically how much you have to rotate to go from A to B, it's very large. Now, this allows them to give a cinematic feel. So whenever you see a scene where character slowly comes into the focus, you can do that with your DSLR, but it will be very painful, and you would not have much control because your lens will have 45 degrees of turn. These puppy can go upwards of more or less 280, and sometimes they can achieve almost 360 degrees. So there is a lot of throw. You can, as a character walking in, you can maintain focus. And basically photographic lenses have lot of electronic stabilization, drive-by-wire. These puppy have none of them. They don't even come with autofocus. It's a very manual, very intimate tool, and they're very expensive. Be mindful, if you think your professional lens for a DSLR is expensive, try one of these. And be mindful, they generally come in sets. So if you buy a set, let's say a Canon Cine lens set, they will have at least 5-6 lenses. You're not supposed to buy one, because even though you can change the camera, the color of a lens is unique to itself. So whenever they are selling you a Cine lens kit, basically a big briefcase with 3 or 4 lenses, they are all matching to each other. So if you change lenses, your film will no longer change color randomly, and color grading cannot fix these things. Now you might be like, okay, I cannot notice that. You cannot, but whenever the color grading, the people who are getting paid for this, they can. That's why cine lenses are so expensive. And in terms of control, they allow you to go even deeper than what a professional camcorder will let you to go. Now these controls are tricky. This is not something that you and I can easily experience or even understand. You have to have a actual understanding and experience in the field to even understand that. So what are the benefits of this sort of equipment? Now first, they try to make sure the sensor, whatever it is, whenever it was made, doesn't matter, whatever the sensor is, sensor to memory, basically whatever you're gonna extract, has a very clear cut path. Now this is the path where you can easily tell the difference between a cheap camera and expensive camera, is that sensor, both of them may have the same sensor. Many cinema cameras from Canon has same sensor as a Canon DSLR series. However, the data line, basically the pathway from the sensor to your memory, it's very compressed. In a cinema camera, they try to make sure it's as untampered as possible. Basically, whatever is coming from the sensor goes raw to the video file. It's a raw system. There is no LUT, there is no such thing. It's basically raw. So you can change almost everything. It's basically whole video is like a raw video format. It's very big in terms of basically storage. And not to mention, when I say you can change things, Red Epic cameras now allow you to have a video format that actually allows you to change ISO after you have shot the film. That's why I told you ISO is just a setting in the camera. It's not a signal to noise ratio, is not that signal to noise ratio is much more important compared to ISO. So if you have a very good signal to noise ratio, you can change the ISO afterwards. Red Epic became the first camera that allows you natively to do this sort of things. Then in terms of memory, now you can understand raw format takes a lot of toll on your memory card when it's just in photo format. Imagine what it will do to your basically SD card if you are trying to do that in video. So it can go upwards of 1, 2, even 3 gigabytes per second. So this sort of formats cannot be handled by your SD card. Even SSDs can barely handle it. So there are SSDs that you can buy. NVMe SSD easily can handle it with no issue. So to remove that bottleneck, the companies that employ this sort of equipment, they employ their own basically storage module, if you will say. As you can see, Red cartridge, Sony cartridges, these are very, very uniquely purpose-built, tested system. They will not fail on you. And most of them, other than Red, generally comes with dual redundancy. Red is the only one that does not give you, and they do fail. So that's why people like dual redundancy. So Sony gives you, and even in Red, you can have external recording systems. So the equipment that you have is completely unique, completely purpose-built. It will not fail you. Now, how do they achieve this sort of thing? Now, if you are familiar with progression of DSLRs, you will always see Ep3, Ep4, Ep5, or like, you know, DG3, DG4, DG5. These are the processors that Canon and Nikon uses. So how do these puppies manage? Well, there is no single processor that can handle this. So what they do is they put 5 or 6 of them, sometimes 8. So yes, they have multi-processor system, and times where they use a high-end processor, as in almost desktop grade processor, they have a cooling solution. That's why if you ever see very high-end Red cameras or even Sony cameras, they have a cooling system. That's for the processor, not for the sensor, for the processor. Now, of course, sensor is also cooled by that. So. But it's primarily because the processor gets extremely hot. Now, when I say you get a raw out of it, what does that truly mean for you? Like, what do you gain? Like, let's say you are like, okay, I will correct for exposure and things like that. But you will be like, hey, I'm experienced enough, I can do it. Like, let's say it's a controlled environment, you took test shots, then raw is no longer useful for you. However, raw also comes with the advantage of what we call deep color. Now, this deep color is a very simple idea. They try to give you the best color gradation possible. Now, that allows you to do proper green screening, that allows you to do proper skin toning, that allows you to, like, you cannot do proper color grading into a scene that is not properly recorded. So imagine the color tint you see in movies like, let's say, Lord of the Ring, there is a bit of yellow to it. You watch movies like Matrix, everything is green. Now you cannot add that kind of thing without it making look very tacky, unless you have a very good color data from your sensor. For this reason, deep color is very important. You can add your feel, the touch, because there are many cameras, many movies that are shot on same camera, but they look different. How do they manage that? That's from this. deep color. Because of that color, they can actually tune it, and very subtle way. Now, that subtle way may not come clearly when you are watching it in your home, but when you are watching it in big IMAX screen or big Real D screen, yeah, it makes a night and day difference. So from that point of view, these are the pros of it. You get completely dedicated hardware that can handle the system. You get completely high quality possible out of the sensor of that generation. So please do not compare a very movie camera that was used for Star Wars prequel trilogy was a full HD camera. Do not compare that to your, that old camera to your current DSLR. Your current DSLR will be better. But if you compare your current generation DSLR to a current generation movie camera, yeah, your movie camera is leaps and bounds ahead. So if there's so many pros, are there any consequences? Well, undeniably so. There is always pros and cons. Now, I already told you, because they use so many processors or sometimes flat out high energy components, they need active cooling, as in air cooling, as in like you will have in exhaust vent, inlet vent. Yes, this is a camera. You have inlet and you have exhaust. So let that sink in. There is an inlet and exhaust in a camera. And you might think, okay, this is made for professionals, they should be able to do long-term recording. No, they can't. Most of them will limit you around 15 to 20 minutes. And you're like, wait a minute. How the heck my DSLR allows me 30 minutes recording and these puppies only 15, 20 minutes. Some can go up to 3 hours max. Red Epic is notorious for that. They only allow you 15 minutes. Think of it this way. This is meant for cinema production. And those of you who are familiar with film projectors that is used for cinema projection, you know the reel size are this big. Now, whenever you see a cinema camera, you must remember the reels are only this size. It can't record that. So people are used to the fact that when they are shooting a movie, they're only shooting like, let's say 1 minute, 3 minutes, 10 minutes maximum. Most scenes are much more smaller than that. So it's no issue for them. So they will shoot multiple scenes and they will keep changing the memory system. It's not meant for interview. You cannot use these for interview. I mean, like, you can, you have to rely on external system, not their own internal basically memory system. So, and not to mention the size of these data file would be enormous. Like you would need actual high-end computer just to process that video format. And for that's why you can't do long-term recording. Now, if you think a camera, digital camera is kind of complex to operate, these puppy will make you cry. These are so complex. So many things is there that into this, specifically regarding with syncing technology, as in the time sync, timestamp, and other things. It's very hard to operate. There is a cameraman whose sole job would be just to make sure the camera works. He's not gonna frame the shot. People are gonna tell him, okay, frame the shot like this. His job will be, okay, I'm gonna set it up. His job will be to record the system. His job would be to white balance everything. His job would be to take care of everything. Like there is one guy dedicated for that. So trust me when I say this is not a pick up and shoot. It's not a point and shoot. It's a very, very meticulous operation. Basically, it's like you are operating a machine, high complexity machine. So it's not something you can like, even though you can afford a Red Epic, it's not as intuitive as you would think. You will be better served with multiple DSLRs. So this was my presentation on cinema movie camera. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. I would urge you to leave a comment on my video. I reply to all of them. And please subscribe. Press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.